Hello to everyone who is watching. I'm here today with Professor Andreas Hoepner to talk about the EU Paris-aligned and climate transition benchmarks. Professor Hoepner is a professor of operational risk, banking and finance at University College Dublin and an independent member of the European Commission's technical expert group on sustainable finance. Hello, Mr. Hoepner.
Hey, thank you for having me.
Thank you. The European Commission has just published the draft delegated regulation, picking up most of the recommendations of the technical expert group. Could you give some background on that process, the work of the technical expert group, and your personal role?
Sure. So the technical expert group was appointed in summer 2018. There is 35 members, 32 of them represent the organizations, for instance, in Germany, Allianz Global Investors, and EnBW and others. And three of them are individuals, and that's Paolo Mazzoni, Brenda Kramer, and myself. So individuals represent themselves, while others represent organizational roles, which means if you represent an organization and you leave the organization, they will nominate someone else. We then had four subgroups, two for climate disclosure and green bonds, and two for the taxonomy and the trajectory each. And the taxonomy, green taxonomy, people may have heard about it, effectively a list of activities that are considered green and thereby available or suitable for subsidy to say. And the one that I was part of, the climate transition benchmarks group, where we are basically developing, in many ways, inventing minimum requirements for benchmarks that follow the IPCC's 1.5 degree trajectory.
Perfect. Thank you for these insights. Coming to the EU climate transition and Paris-aligned benchmarks, could you briefly introduce what are the main goals and ideas of the two new types of benchmarks?
Absolutely. So existing low-carbon benchmarks are lower carbon than the mainstream benchmark. So they may be 20, 30, 40% below mainstream benchmark in terms of greenhouse gas emissions intensity. The challenge with that is that if the world emits more, so the world goes in the wrong direction, and the mainstream benchmark is rising, then being 30% below mainstream benchmark still means that your actual emissions are rising and we're not going to achieve our net zero 2050 goal, which the European Commission committed to in 2018 and the European Union member states, except Poland, committed to in 2019. So to actually achieve net zero by 2050, which means that we're effectively balancing the emissions that we have as a planet, the remaining emissions that we have as a planet against the emission sinks, natural sinks, or technological means to capture emissions, we have to invent an investment style that has effectively a declining balance in greenhouse gas emissions. So that gradually goes down following the IPCC trajectory. And this investment style is climate transition investing, and the two benchmarks representing it is a climate transition benchmark and the Paris aligned benchmark. They simply differ in, if you want, so severity of the trajectories. They both have a 7% trajectory, but the starting point for the climate transition benchmark, so-called CTB, is at minus 30%. The starting point for the Paris-aligned benchmark is at minus 50%.
Okay, great. Thank you. And from your perspective, are there any areas of the methodology that are worth highlighting?
Yes, there's several. So to start with, if climate change was a disease, say cancer, then fossil fuel scope 3 emissions are the actual cause. So when you look at what really causes climate change, it's fossil fuel scope 3 emissions that causes the vast majority of the problem. There are some emissions from cement or the farming sector that also are unrelated to fossil fuel scope 3, but they're the minority. And so we are immediately introducing coverage of scope 3 emissions from the fossil fuel sector. That means that fossil fuel companies, their suppliers, all suppliers, not only utility suppliers as part of scope 2, but all other suppliers as well. And most importantly, their customers, and so the use of their product is included in the computation of the index. So including scope 3 emissions from day 1 and then other scope 3 emissions after 2 or 4 years, or even a benchmark administrator once earlier, is the first huge difference to existing approaches. The second difference is that we're actually aiming to focus on absolute greenhouse gas emissions. So either it's reductions in absolute greenhouse gas emissions for unlisted fixed income securities, or it is greenhouse gas intensity measures, but then with an inflation adjustment, which is equivalent to a reduction in absolute greenhouse gas emissions. And the IPCC's actual curve obviously is also absolute greenhouse gas emissions, because the planet has to reduce total greenhouse gas emissions not greenhouse gas emissions scaled by a certain factor. To give an example with the scaling, when you look at countries, for instance, most countries are making commitments to the Paris Agreement to reduce their absolute greenhouse gas emissions. Some countries, say in Africa, are committing to reduce their greenhouse gas emissions divided by GDP. The challenge with that is, of course, if GDP grows a lot, the greenhouse gas intensity can decline, but the actual greenhouse gas emissions are much higher. So the focus is on absolute greenhouse gas emissions and really following the IPCC. And when it comes to intensity, we're dividing by enterprise value, including cash, which is a balanced measure of an investor's worthiness of that particular security. We're not dividing by revenue because revenue bias is in favor of coal and integrated oil and gas companies, since these ones are the ones that have low market multiple to revenue ratios, since their revenues are worth little due to the stranded assets.
That's indeed very interesting, and I'm sure very valuable for our clients, so thank you. And what is your expectation for the impact of the Paris-aligned and climate transition benchmarks on the indexing ecosystem, investing in general, and last but not least, the environment?
So let's start with the indexing ecosystem. We're very pleased to have seen the launches of Paris-aligned and climate transition benchmarks by MSCI, by ISS Solactive, the study concept by Dow Jones S&P, the ideas from FTSE and Bloomberg. So we're very pleased to see the vast majority of relevant index providers putting forward very good concepts and taking on board. Also, as of today, those indexes that are already live have an impressive performance. And that was not only due to the shock to oil companies and the COVID crisis, but also due to the general construction, I would argue. So for the indexing environment, I think that's great. It's effectively a new concept of index because it's a declining balance, so an absolutely sustainable index, not only relatively better than benchmark, but absolutely more sustainable than it was last year. That's maybe a very important point to highlight. A relative sustainable benchmark, or relatively sustainable benchmark, is more sustainable than the plain index in a given year, but it's not necessarily more sustainable than itself was last year. An absolutely sustainable benchmark is more sustainable than the plain index in the given year and more sustainable than itself was last year. And so for the indexing environment, that's a new philosophy, and I'm pretty sure that will be very popular. Generally speaking, the concept of climate transition investing, however, can of course be applied anywhere. You didn't necessarily have to build an index. You can use it with an active fund. In fact, some active funds are claiming they're already doing it and are 60, 70% below benchmark. So for investing overall, we think that climate transition investing will be a philosophy that investors will likely want to adopt if they're aiming for absolute sustainability and for net zero by 2050. When we're looking at the impact that this has on the environment, I'm very positive that the impact it will have on the ability of fossil fuel companies to refinance themselves, especially to the fixed income indexes and to activities and bank loans, will be significant in the sense that digging and drilling will become more expensive, and that's certainly a good thing for the planet.
Perfect. Yeah, thank you very much for taking the time to explain the work of the Technical Expert Group and the European Commission, and especially for sharing some of your views with us in this context. That's much appreciated. Thank you very much.
Thanks.